Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. The program will begin shortly. Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. Our program is about to begin. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome tonight's Master of Ceremonies, President, Students for Liberty, Alexander McCobin.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the 2016 Students for Liberty Awards Dinner. My name is Alexander McCobin, and I'm one of the founders and president of Students for Liberty. Many of you, like myself, have probably been following the 2016 election cycle with incredulous wonder. Rather than providing substantive debate about contemporary American policies, it seems like we're being set up for a joke. A pathological liar, a democratic socialist, and a reality TV star all walk into a bar. The punchline is one of them's probably going to be president. At least it's provided tonight's keynote speaker, PJ O'Rourke, with plenty of fodder and material that we're going to enjoy from him tonight. But there is one reassuring thing about this election cycle. Just that. It's part of a cycle. It's not permanent. There is still hope to fix things in the future. And even if we take a step backwards sometimes, so long as we take two steps forward, we will continue to make progress. I remember what it was like 15 years ago when my dad gave me a copy of Atlas Shrugged for my birthday. It took me a month to read over the summer, but by the time I finished, I wanted to learn more. Now, 15 years ago, pretty much the only way I could do that was by ordering VHS tapes of Ayn Rand interviews from a catalog. We are living in a very different world today from back then. Even by the time I went off to college in 2004, when I was a dedicated libertarian, things were incredibly different. For the first 2 years, I didn't meet a single other person who thought the same way I did, and I nearly gave up. There was no credible national figure espousing these views. There were few students on campus who even knew what the word libertarian meant. And there was no organization providing students with the support or resources they needed to spread the principles of liberty on their campus. After 2 years, I decided I would start my own group and see what happened. A handful of students started to come out to meetings, and from there, I met a handful of students from other schools who were running their own clubs. We organized a 12-person roundtable discussion on best practices for student organizing, which we turned into what we thought would be a 30-person conference to continue the conversation, and ended up drawing 100 attendees from 42 schools. At the time, no one thought that was possible. It was an incredible feeling and accomplishment. But that's nothing like what we have today. Students for Liberty has exploded in just 8 years into a movement of over 80,000 students amongst 2,800 student groups, supported by 1,400 trained student leaders in over 100 countries. That is a radical change from where things were when we started 8 years ago. But while Students for Liberty has been growing over the past 8 years, our opposition has been doing the same. It may be difficult to find a campus without a libertarian group or activism these days, but obviously the same is true of finding campuses with Sanders supporters and support for explicit socialism. The most popular event in Students for Liberty's groups tends to be these things called free speech walls. You might have seen one down in the exhibit hall this weekend, where students and faculty can write anything they want in order to celebrate this most fundamental right. Yet, this past semester, an anti-free speech movement has swept campuses across the country. Now more than ever, we need to spread this philosophy to young people and empower them to stand up for the principles of a free society. And that's why Students for Liberty's work is so important. Our mission is to educate, develop, and empower the next generation of leaders of liberty. That means introducing libertarianism to young people through books, campus speakers, online courses, conferences, and any other resources we can develop. Once we introduce those ideas to young people, we develop their leadership skills, both by providing theoretical and practical training on how to start groups, organize events, persuasively speak and write, all to make a difference in their communities. And once they're committed to liberty and have the skills to be effective advocates, we empower them with resources, tools, and encouragement to go out and change the world. Because that's what we're here to do. We're here to change the world, to become a freer place. And there are two things that change the world: people and ideas. We know we have the right ideas. There are tomes of literature proving that liberty is both philosophically correct and practically desirable for the world. What liberty has lacked for too long and still lacks today are enough of the right people to go out and turn those ideas into reality. This organization, this conference, and the awards that we're about to give out tonight are working to change that. Now, I want to make sure to thank a number of individuals who have made this evening possible, our host committee for this dinner, and Students for Liberty's work in general. Park Bostrom, Durwood and Joanna Chase, Louis Chiavecchi, Arthur Danchik, Dan Grossman, Ethel Mae Humphreys, David and Karen Peterson, John Kunze, Don and Julie Smith, Victor Sparandeo, Tito Tedamonte, and John Utley. Thank you so much for sponsoring tonight's dinner to make this possible. We have so many incredible supporters in this room tonight, but I also want to make a special thank you to John Chisholm, who's at this conference autographing copies of his new book, Unleash Your Inner Company, which are available at the reception throughout the rest of this weekend. He has generously offered to donate all of the proceeds from his sales this weekend to Students for Liberty, so I encourage you to go check out this book, an incredible how-to manual for anyone who wants to be an effective leader for liberty. Students for Liberty is working to make the world a freer place. And what we're celebrating tonight is something that we've been doing since the second International Students for Liberty Conference, recognizing and honoring Students for Liberty's top leaders for their outstanding work in this regard. From the beginning, we knew that in order to create a sustainable student movement, we needed to not only share the best practices for student organizing throughout our network, but we needed to recognize those who are doing great things, both to show them they are appreciated, but perhaps more importantly, to show others that no matter what else may be happening in the world, there are people doing great things that should inspire us to do the same. Over the years, we have recognized some amazing individuals. Leah Polagashvili, who won the 2010 Student of the Year Award, is nominated again this year for Alumnus of the Year for her work in economics, not only getting a tenure-track job right out of graduate school, but also promoting economic education through op-eds in publications like the Wall Street Journal. The UC Berkeley Students for Liberty, which won the 2011 Student Group of the Year Award, has sent alumni to work in the nonprofit sector, like here at Students for Liberty, but also to for-profit organizations that are changing the world, like Uber. And events like the 2014 event of the year, Restart Balkans by Students for Liberty Greece. Let me mention that again, Students for Liberty in Greece in the past 2 years. Show us that these ideas can be advanced in the harshest climates. In short, these awards are meaningful both for the recipients who receive them tonight, but also for the entire movement. Now, to present the awards, it's my pleasure to introduce one of the co-founders of Students for Liberty and the chairwoman of our board of directors. While graduating from Cornell University, working for City Year, getting her master's in public policy from the University of Chicago, and working for various research and consulting firms over the years, she has continued to provide incredible guidance and support for Students for Liberty's growth. The first time she and I discussed putting on the original Students for Liberty conference, I remember asking her, "Sloane, do you have any idea how much this one event is going to take? How much work this is going to be?" She answered yes. I think it's safe to say she had no idea what she was getting herself into, and we are all thankful for that. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage, Sloane Frost.
For all the international growth, Alexander's tuxedo reminds me you still have to make penguins for Liberty. As exciting it is to be with you all for the 9th International Students for Liberty Conference, which is still amazing to say, I'd like to take a moment to recognize some of the SFLers who are no longer with us. John David Fernandez was a student at Columbia University. He tabled at our very first SFL conference in New York, and he was a proud advocate of Austrian economics. Sarah Greether was one of the first attendees I met at our first SFL conference. She was a student from Michigan. And if you ever met Sarah, you remember this giant smile she always had on her face and an incredible ability to speak with people regardless of their backgrounds or political affiliations. Brad Peterson was a student, Students for Liberty campus coordinator at Temple University in Philadelphia, and he would have transferred to Cornell. He was an engineer, an entrepreneur. He had ideas to revolutionize companies, but he also was a great community builder. And you knew that if you ever need anything, you go to Brad. When I first moved to New Jersey, he offered to help me find an apartment. He was always willing to lend a hand. Sam Tenney was a member of the first Students for Liberty Executive Board from 2008 to 2009. And he also didn't know what he was getting himself into, and he thought he was joining an objectivist student group. And when he found out we weren't only objectivists, he resigned from the board, and we all really respected that as the first time we'd seen someone take a very principled stand. So he was always an advocate for his opinions and very much respected for that. Andrew Kaluza was an SFL campus coordinator as well. He was one of the fathers of the Texas Liberty Movement. We joke about him as being this guy who would hug anyone he ever saw. He was friends with anyone in not only the Liberty Movement but abroad. If he met you, he'd say, "Oh, what are you interested in? What do you care about?" He wanted to know people. And he's one of the people that spearheaded getting buses to bring students from all over the country, all over the US, here to DC for the conference, because he wanted everyone to enjoy what it meant to be part of the Students for Liberty family. KJ Herr was also a member of the Texas Student Movement, and he was a transplant to Texas from South Carolina, and he didn't quite know what was going on in Texas, so he sought out some friends to start a student group, and he and Kaluza and some of the other guys in Texas did a wonderful job and always just wanted to talk to people. KJ wanted to make socks for Liberty. He had great ideas about how to change the world. So to honor their memory, I'd like to ask each of you to join me in a moment of silence. Thank you. The amazing students that we've had the pleasure of working with over the years from SFL are wonderful examples of what it can be not only to be an advocate for liberty, but an amazing human being as well. The passion that they have to fight for these causes day in, day out on campuses that are sometimes very hostile to the ideas are inspirational for all of us. And so tonight it's my pleasure to honor some of those students, groups, and events that have garnered all our attention all over the world this year. To start off with, we recognize the event of the year, which honors the most effective student-run event for advancing the cause of liberty. The first nominee is El Toborachi Libertad from Universidad Santa Cruz in Bolivia. In December of 2015, Es Libertad Bolivia held El Toborachi Libertad event celebrating the third anniversary of their organization. The event was at the Chamber of Industry and Commerce of Santa Cruz, and it had 532 attendees, television press, newspapers, and recognized even by Bolivian authorities. The next event was the debate to decriminalize prostitution held at the Hebrew University of Jerusalem in Israel. The libertarians group at Hebrew University organized a debate on whether or not to decriminalize prostitution this year. Two teams of debaters discussed the pros and cons of each side, and they also featured a former prostitute to testify about the dangers of the profession. Then they had a little vote afterwards, and the consensus among the audience was that the debate showed that it would be better to legalize prostitution to make it safer. The next nominee is the Gustavo Franco Lecture, hosted by DCE IMEC in Brazil. And I have to apologize because, as a student of the American public school system, my pronunciation is terrible. DCE IMEC organized an event hosting Gustavo Franco, a former president of the Central Bank of Brazil and creator of the Plano Real that stabilized the Brazilian economy in the 1990s. Franco is considered the most influential economist in Brazil today. The event had more than 400 participants, consisting not only of students, but professors, staff, and local entrepreneurs. The president of the university even watched the event and was very pleased afterwards. And including all the professors and deans attending the event means that the room reached its maximum capacity. And our next nominee is a liberal youth seminar hosted in Hong Kong. Now, a lot of us think of Hong Kong as being a reverent example of free market economics at work. But the Chinese Special Economic Zone has not had an active libertarian student movement in its entire history. That all changed in 2015 when Students for Liberty Hong Kong was founded. The group hosted its first liberal youth seminar in the city's history, bringing together a promising group of libertarian student leaders at the University of Hong Kong. The seminar was 2 days long, and it received great press attention for being one of Hong Kong's most unique student events. And our final nominee for event of the year is Liberty Classes, hosted by Kiev National Economic University in Ukraine. Now, as we know, Ukraine is going through a difficult political time. But a group of libertarian students in the country organized a series of lectures for students about the fundamental principles of free market thought. In 2015, the group successfully held Liberty Classes at the Kiev National Economic University. Lecturers included prominent economists, journalists, politicians, writers, and historians. The classes continue to this day, and so far they've reached more than 1,500 participants. And the winner of the 2016 Event of the Year goes to, we get a drum roll, the Gustavo Franco Lecture hosted by DCE IMEC in Brazil.
I'm so nervous. I'm so excited to receive this award. I would like to thank you all for your support for Students for Liberty community. I would like to thank you, especially my mom, Gustavo Franco, and Salim Mater for their incredible support. Sorry. Sometimes We say that liberty is coming, but liberty is not coming. Liberty is already here. Thank you.
Incidentally, she also receives the Best Dressed of the Evening Award. And our next award of the evening is for the Student Group of the Year. Clube Juliano, please. Ajuricaba. Yes, okay. He tried to help me one year, and it was Facopilia, and I still remember trying to say it, and I don't mean to be disrespectful, I promise. Clube Ajuricaba in Amazon in Brazil. The club is the biggest libertarian student group in the north of Brazil. More than 60 local coordinators from the group and 50 students participate, which is based in Manaus, the largest city in the Amazon forest. The group aims to ignite the liberty movement in the Amazonian society, focusing on changing the deep socialist ties that exist among the community. The club is only 1 year old, but it's already expanding into small cities across the region. Our next nominee is Eagles for Liberty out of Florida Gulf Coast University. As one of the fastest growing groups at Florida Gulf Coast University, Eagles for Liberty has initiated frequent and meaningful pro-liberty events, such as guest speakers, interactive tabling activities, and free speech chalkboard wall, which Alexander was referring to, in celebration of our First Amendment rights. Most notably, the club hosted SFL's first ever Florida Gulf Coast Regional Conference, which hosted over 70 students from both the east and west coasts of Florida, which is an amazing feat if you've ever been to Florida. The group has hosted many big name speakers and will be hosting an SFL focus series on free market environmentalism in the spring. Es Libertad Venezuela has our next nominee, the Universidad Central de Venezuela. In November of 2015, Es Libertad Venezuela held their first ever regional conference in Caracas. It was a huge success that brought together the best advocates of liberty and 200 student attendees. This conference was held despite university shutdowns that forced the students to change their plans and move the event less than a month before it was due to occur. Es Libertad Venezuela also held a national meeting of Students for Freedom, where 77 student leaders eager to defend freedom attended from across the entire country. Every time that Es Libertad Venezuela team defends freedom in their country, they put their lives in danger to stand for safety and their freedom. It's a difficult thing, and it's an amazing thing, and I'm glad that they're an inspiration for all of us. Our next nominee is the Maastricht Students for Liberty in Maastricht University. They are a leading example of what a group can achieve even on a relatively small campus. Within 3 years, the group has managed to become one of the most active libertarian student groups across all of Europe. They organize lectures with attendees of up to 450 people. They've hosted 3 conferences, and they maintain both an active blog and a social media presence. Our final nominee for Student Group of the Year is Students for Individual Liberty at the University of Virginia in the US. During 2015, Students for Individual Liberty had several big events that engaged group members, students at UVA, and members of the greater Charlottesville, Virginia area to spread the ideas of liberty, which included an Incarceration Nation panel, a Farming and Fear event, which consisted of a documentary screening and a Q&A about government regulation and intervention in small business and family farming, and a classical liberal roundtable discussion, which occurs every other week. That's a lot of planning. Students for Individual Liberty brought 13 students to the ISFLC last year, and they put a lot of effort into building both their group community and contributions to the broader liberty movement. And the winner of the 2016 Group of the Year goes to Clube Ajuricaba in Amazon, Brazil.
Yeah, unfortunately, the Ajuricaba leadership weren't able to be here today. So as responsible for the programs in Brazil, I would like to thank you for all your support around the world, especially in Brazil. And as you may know, Brazil is not a free country. We are far from this point for the United States, for example. And the left is a dominant force in politics, but they are losing ground now in the academia and the student movement in general. And Clube Juricaba is one of the biggest responsible for this change in Brazil, and more exactly in the Amazon region. Maybe half of Brazil contemplates the Amazon region, and the left is very powerful there. They are influenced not only the universities, but they are confronting the politicians about corruption. They're trying to raise in tax, and they're able to block these tentatives. And there is even one interesting story that some of their coordinators, they need to travel hours by boat through the Amazon River to go to the events. And they really deserve this prize, and I hope I can deliver to them in Brazil. And many thanks for you all.
And we'll be taking a short break for the rest of the dinner portion of the evening, and I'll return shortly for our next anticipated awards. Thank you.